Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, now celebrating their 125th anniversary. From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. This week, we're going to look at how and why people make personal eating choices. Investigative reporter Nina Teicholz shares some shocking revelations about how America got so dietarily off track, with help in part from the American Heart Association. And Wynnie Stein of the Moosewood Collective reflects on how a small band of hippies came together in the early 70s, forever changing the role that vegetables play on our plates. Then we're going all Hollywood with an insider's scoop on this year's ultimate foodie film, The 100-Foot Journey. There are some delicious surprises coming your way on this week's Louisiana Eats. In the second half of the 20th century, dietary fat was scapegoated as the source of America's health problems. Medical experts and government organizations came up with a new system that advocated a low-fat diet with plenty of vegetables, fruits, and grains. But over the course of 60 years, our health has only gotten worse. There's been a spike in diabetes, obesity, and heart disease, the very same disease we originally set out to obliterate. So what if the system's broken, not us? That's the basic premise of Nina Teicholz's new book, The Big Fat Surprise. Nina's joining us by phone to help trace this story. Nina, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So let's take it from the top. Why were Americans looking to change their dietary habits back in the 1950s?
In the 1950s, the nation really faced a growing, terrifying tide of heart disease. It had risen from seemingly out of nowhere in the 1920s to become the nation's number one killer. And President Eisenhower himself had a heart attack in 1955 and was out of the Oval Office. So this was a subject that had everyone's attention. And there were a number of theories about what was causing heart disease. And one scientist, whose name was Ansel Keys, a pathologist at the University of Minnesota, he proposed that it was saturated fats that caused heart disease. They would clog the arteries and cause high cholesterol and thereby cause a heart attack. That was the theory. But he was this very outsized, powerful, charismatic man who managed to get his idea implanted into the American Heart Association and the very first national guidelines telling men to cut back on saturated fats, meat, cheese, butter, dairy, eggs, cut back on those fats as a way to prevent heart disease. Those very first national guidelines were published in 1961, and that was the beginning of our demonization of those kinds of foods.
Well, I'm curious, in your research, you know, often you'll find big money behind bad ideas. Did you find that there was any big unsaturated fat money that was pushing this, or was it really just almost the cult of Dr. Keys?
It was both of those things. There was definitely the hand of big food behind the American Heart Association. The American Heart Association was this sort of sleepy, tiny little cardiology society that was always in financial straits. And in 1948, Procter & Gamble made the American Heart Association the beneficiary of a radio show. And overnight, millions of dollars flowed into the American Heart Association coffers and transformed it into the national powerhouse that it is today. They opened chapters across the country. They became a huge volunteer organization. And coincidentally, the American Heart Association was recommending that everybody switch to vegetable oils, such as Crisco oil, which was one of the main products of Procter & Gamble. So there has always been the hand of big food behind our nutrition recommendations in the country, and that has been the story throughout history, going back to the 1940s when all these early food manufacturers were organizing themselves, and they realized that one of their tactics had to be to influence the whole course of science, nutrition science. But it is also true that the mistakes that have been made in nutrition science seem to me to be primarily ones of science. Scientists taking extremely weak evidence and in the face of this urgent public health problem, really jumping the gun, using weak science to try to come to conclusions that just weren't supported by the evidence. And that's been true throughout the history of our nutrition recommendations.
It's really, really, really confusing. It's confusing to everybody. And, you know, the irony is that, you know, the American Heart Association comes out with these recommendations. And instead of fixing things, diabetes, obesity, and heart disease all spike while this low-fat diet is being intended to cure these diseases and promote it as such. So could you sort of give us a roadmap for how you think all this irony came about?
Well, your observation is absolutely true, which is that Americans are now fatter, more diabetic. The underlying rates of heart disease have hardly dropped at all, even though it seems that we have made improvements in how to treat the disease. And Americans, on the whole, even though nutrition experts tell us that we are lazy and eat too much, we have also, on the whole, really complied with the dietary guidelines that we've been given. So we have cut back on saturated fats by 11% over the last 30 years. We've ramped up our fruits and vegetables by 17% and our carbohydrates overall by about 25%. So we have complied with the dietary guidelines, and we are not healthier for having done that. So that, you know, creates a kind of conundrum that science has to deal with. Why is it that we look so much worse while eating so much more carbohydrates, as we've been told, and fruits and vegetables? And I think the fundamental mistake in our dietary guidelines was telling Americans to cut back on foods that had long been at the centerpiece of our dining room tables: meat, cheese, butter, dairy, eggs. They are filling, nutritious foods. They've always been at the center of our dinner plates. And we have replaced those, clearly, with carbohydrates, with more pasta, bread, grains. We now know from the last decade of really good clinical trials that have been done, they clearly, unequivocally demonstrate that a diet high in carbohydrates and low in fat produces greater obesity and more higher risk of heart disease and diabetes than a diet that is high in fat and low in carbohydrates. You know, another way of saying that is that Dr. Atkins, even though he was vilified and seen as a fattest diet doctor in his day, he was closer to the truth about what would produce weight loss and good health than the low-fat diet that we have been trying to follow for all these years.
Well, based on that fact, how should people even know who to believe and what to believe?
That is, I think, a very important question in nutrition for our times. And I think there is basically a war out there on nutrition going on right now, which is to say that our expert panels, which are controlled by a very small number of what I call nutrition aristocrats who serve on all the same expert panels and really control our dietary policy, they are approaching a line of thought that is really close to a vegan diet. They're ratcheting back their recommendations on saturated fat to be ever lower because they see that the nation is not getting healthier on what they've recommended so far. And by contrast, there is a huge growing movement among scientists and also practitioners of people who are starting to follow a high-fat, low-carbohydrate diet and seeing spectacular results. And there are books and conferences dedicated to that line of thought. And these are completely diametrically opposed ideas about how to become healthy. So this will play itself out, I think, over the coming years. But at the moment, there is no central authoritative voice that I think really has a good answer.
Well, how do you defend your research when people attack it? Have you been in contentious interviews or conversations with people who try to discredit your research? Tell me about that.
I haven't had too many people say that my basic research is wrong or that any of the book's assertions are wrong, because they are extremely well defended.
Yeah, you've got some footnotes in that book, girlfriend.
I do. I have thousands of footnotes in that book.
Uh-huh.
And I get attacks from the vegan community, who really believe that their plant-based diet is best. One of the things that I did, although it wasn't comprehensive, was to analyze some of the data behind the idea that a vegan diet is the healthiest. And it turns out there's just a surprisingly slim evidence base for the idea that a plant-based diet is healthy. It really amounts to maybe one or two tiny clinical trials. So the criticism that I get comes from that angle. And that's because, on the whole, the expert community has been moving away from a low-fat diet generally. So there is a kind of welcoming of the message that we can eat more fats. That's been going on for maybe the last 5 years now. Really, it comes down to what we say about saturated fats, red meat and cheese and butter. It's just a question of how much and what is healthy.
Well, looking into your crystal ball, what would you predict is going to happen to the country if we all start to adopt these habits?
Well, I think that one note of caution, which is that if you pursue a high-fat diet, it really is important to keep carbohydrates, sugar, refined carbohydrates, all those carbohydrates low. That's a key factor in, I think, promoting good health, which is to not eat a lot of sugar, and that those kinds of calories are unhealthy, clearly. But, you know, meat, cheese, butter, dairy, eggs, cracklins that you have in the South, those foods are incredibly dense nutritionally. The combination of protein and fat seem to be highly satiating, so that you don't eat as much. You maybe don't eat as many calories. They're full of good nutrients and minerals. And I really believe the research shows that we were healthier when we ate a diet higher in those foods, and that we would be again if we returned to them.
Well, Nina, that's quite a new look on fats and fat food for us. And I'm so glad we were able to have this conversation.
Well, thank you very much for having me on the show.
Nina Teicholz and her new book, The Big Fat Surprise.
Eat a cow, cause it's good for you. Eat a cow, it's a thing that goes.
Dynamic mother-daughter duo Tracy and Terry Paulding are the creative caterers behind Paulding and Company in San Francisco. One of their brilliant brainstorms produced the ultimate healthy snack, spicy, cheesy kale chips with no cheese involved at all. First, make sure to purchase ultra-fresh organic vegetables for this. Start off by soaking 2.5 cups of raw cashews in water for 3 to 4 hours. Drain off the water and put the cashews in a blender with some red bell pepper and red Fresno pepper, freshly squeezed lemon juice, salt, and nutritional yeast. Nutritional yeast is different from baking yeast. Just ask for it at your favorite health food store, and don't worry, they've got it. Puree the mixture together and taste it, upping the lemon juice or salt as needed. There are lots of kinds of kale available these days, but you'll want to use only curly kale in this recipe. Wash your kale well and strip the stems by holding the stem in one hand and pulling up the length of the leaf. The tough part will come off, leaving the tasty, tender part intact. Toss the pureed mixture together with the kale, making sure to coat it well. Then, lay them out in a single layer on wire racks. You can dehydrate them in your food dehydrator overnight, or bake them in your oven on a very low heat. I'm talking 125 degrees or less, until they're very dried and very crisp. That should take about an hour. Then, store them in Ziploc bags. here's a word of warning. If they're not dry enough, they're going to soften up in the bag. They are absolutely addictive, but very low in fat and calories, so gobble them up to your heart's content. They're actually good for you. I'm Poppy Tooker, and Paulding and Company's spicy, cheesy kale chips are real Louisiana eats. When we come back, Wynnie Stein of the Moosewood Collective takes us back to the 70s for a look at how the American vegetarian movement got its start. Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. Wynnie Stein's been chef and Moosewood Collective member for over 30 years. During her time there, Moosewood has grown from a small natural foods restaurant to a large, nationally acclaimed company instrumental in mainstreaming the world of vegetarian cooking.
The Moosewood Collective is just our term for the group that manages and runs and writes the cookbooks. We started this business in 1973. It was a group of seven friends from the area. Ithaca has Cornell University and Ithaca College and a number of other colleges in the area. But in the early 70s, a lot of people migrated here for the so-called Back to the Land movement. So a lot of people wanted to stay after college. So back to this group of seven friends, they loved to cook, they loved to eat. They had never run a restaurant and knew how to run a restaurant, but they decided to start a vegetarian natural foods restaurant in downtown Ithaca.
The young collective, propelled by the idealistic 60s, ventured to turn the traditional restaurant management structure on its head.
Basically, when we were young in our 20s, we really thought that we could create a restaurant management scenario where everybody would learn all the different jobs to run the restaurant. And back then, there were only 36 seats. Now we're looking at like close to 175 with the outside patio opened because we've expanded twice. But in the beginning, everyone was trained to work in the kitchen, but not everybody loved it, right? You have to have a special affinity for, you know, being so hot and so sweaty and pumping out and the adrenaline. And I love it, actually, but not everybody does. And some people are better as servers, whereas if we took some of our cooks who are still here and put them as servers, we would probably be out of business because they cannot deal with people. Lots of people did both kinds of jobs, but we, after a time, realized that, you know, no, not everybody's suited for being a cook or being a server or being a manager, and people gravitated to jobs that they were more suited to. So everybody did learn all those jobs, and there was a real smart seed to all that because people could take responsibility for different parts of the restaurant. If someone got sick or they weren't, you know, coming into work for whatever reason, we all understood how the restaurant worked. It was a work in progress, in fact. And that actually evolved into us having monthly meetings where the group that became the Moosewood Collective, when that first group of seven owners decided to move on and become lawyers and all kinds of serious people in the world. There were still some very early people who had been working at the restaurant who actually acquired it and then formed the Moosewood Collective. In name only, it's not a legal term. It's not like a cooperative where you file papers with the state. And in a sense, it was a way for everyone to have a voice and run the business. As we got bigger and started getting, you know, lots of cookbook contracts and getting a lot of national attention and expanding the restaurant, we actually became more like shareholders in our business. We started issuing shares for work, and we also formed two different management teams, a board for the restaurant and a board for our intellectual property and other businesses. So, like I said, we started out very idealistic and
in our 20s trying to do something very alternative, and it did create a working environment where people took a lot of pride in creating this.
Their radical management structure was only one way that Moosewood was shaking things up. At a time when the farm-to-table movement was still in its infancy, Moosewood was emphasizing nutrition and the importance of eating local through their restaurant menu and cookbooks.
Well, I think we were one of the visionaries, honestly, about that, just trying to look at more healthful ingredients and eating closer to the source and understanding how to revamp some of the favorite recipes that people are handing down in their families that become, you know, part of whatever birthday celebration you're doing or a holiday celebration. We really try to take everyone's loved recipes from our own families, from our friends' families sometimes, and add back in the healthier ingredients that people could use, as well as looking at what could be maybe lower fat or, you know, watching not having too much dairy in a lot of recipes. Because in the beginning, we just slathered everything with cheese and sour cream. And, you know, it was like, just let's just go for it. But after a while, we realized, wait a minute, that's not smart either. And we wrote actually a book called Moosewood Restaurant Low-Fat Favorites. And that won a James Beard Award. And it's not just because the recipes were low-fat, but they were so creative. They took a good look at how you can make delicious food that's healthier. Here's the other thing. Our menu changes every meal at Moosewood. So our menu planners are constantly tweaking and creating and innovating recipes that can be fresh and wonderful for that day's menu.
Now, the recipes, the food, there's a great deal of ethnicity that's reflected.
Yes, absolutely.
And I was curious, is this ethnicity reflected as a result of the people who came to cook the food or eat the food or travels you all went on? How did that happen?
I think all the points you've just hit on are why the food is a very good representation of ethnic cooking, round-the-world cooking with a big comfort food flair. I mean, what I think we're very proud of is we were one of the first people to be writing about and emphasizing using whole grains and whole foods and natural ingredients and looking to other cultures where it hadn't been sanitized, like the American culture in the 50s had sanitized a lot of the food. And what I mean by that is, you know, not having whole grains anymore in recipes or just using white flour or maybe just using white sugar. Not to say that sometimes that isn't the best thing to use in a recipe, but we really wanted to look at how could these recipes that we were sharing with people be much more healthful and interesting than there were our backgrounds. For example, I'm from a Jewish family, and I wrote the Jewish chapter in the Sundays at Moosewood cookbook. Those were a lot of ethnic recipes that came from my family and my best friend, who was a Sephardic Jew. So there were really interesting recipes that I could change a bit to make them a little more healthful. And a lot of us came from backgrounds like that. And we've also been lucky to have people from all over the world cook in our restaurant and bring their recipes.
Am I correct that what you just described about tweaking a recipe is something that you refer to as moosewoodizing a recipe?
You picked up on that, huh?
Yeah. I thought that was so funny.
We always say, oh, yeah, we really moosewoodized the heck out of that one. yep, that's exactly it. It's taking maybe, you know, a meat-based recipe like Portuguese white bean and kale soup, okay, that would have typically sausage in it, and moosewoodizing it, adding perhaps sun-dried tomatoes and a lot of ground fennel to replace that flavor that people are expecting, and actually making a more complex flavor profile out of it. Sometimes I think we've actually enhanced a traditional recipe, and sometimes we've changed it completely, and that's what we call moosewoodizing.
Since the late 70s, Moosewood has published 13 cookbooks that have influenced generations of healthful eaters. When they celebrated their 40th anniversary, Wynnie noticed changing attitudes among people who once shied away from their vision.
I'm seeing more older people coming to our restaurant, inquiring about our cookbooks, writing to us on Facebook, on our website. People that probably 20 years ago would not have been interested in coming to Moosewood, but they're making special trips because Moosewood is actually pretty far off the beaten track. Ithaca is in the Finger Lakes region of upstate New York, and it's about 4.5 hours from New York. It's about 6 hours from Boston, 7 hours. So people have to make this a destination, and we're getting so many older people who are changing their diets and want to live longer and be healthier. So that's really interesting to me. It's more like the mainstream is right in line with what we do. And, you know, that's fabulous to just see another way to be reaching an audience.
Yeah, it's great to have become a destination location. And in some ways, I imagine people almost regard visiting Moosewood as a pilgrimage.
They do, and I can tell you, I've done many different jobs for Moosewood. I've been here for 30 years, but now these days I'm mostly representing the front of the house and greeting a lot of people and talking to them, and I'm amazed how many people are still coming from all over the world, frankly, saying this is on their so-called bucket list. I don't know if I love that term, but coming because they've either been raised on our cookbooks, or they've raised their children on our cookbooks, or they've heard about us from a friend. And I'm just going to say it, we're just still amazed at how far-reaching our brand and who comes to see us and how much we're loved. Not because we're not proud of our work, but because we were doing something that was just very close to our own lifestyle. We didn't have grand visions for Moosewood in the beginning. This was truly a folk phenomenon. We credit our fans and all the people who have supported us over the years with why we are where we are today.
Well, I want to thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us on Louisiana Eats.
Thank you, Poppy. It's been great.
Thanks, Wynnie. Wynnie Stein, author, chef, and member of the Moosewood Collective. With groups like Moosewood popularizing vegetarian and vegan cuisine over the last four decades, interest in plant-based diets has moved from the fringe into the mainstream. This is certainly true in Louisiana, which has seen a groundswell of vegetarian enthusiasm over the past several years. Each spring, vegetarians and vegans from across the state migrate to the New Orleans Veggie Fest to build connections, meet new chefs, attend lectures, and of course, try free food samples. Our sound engineer, Joe Schreiner, sent us a postcard from this year's Veggie Fest.
Would you like to try this key lime pie?
Oh, yeah.
That is all raw, vegan. I'll get you some too.
My name is Dana Nesbitt. I'm the president of the Humane Society of Louisiana and also the chair of NOLA Veggie Fest. We've been promoting veganism here in Louisiana for about 25 years, and we're glad to see that there's a lot more interest now than there used to be. I think that veganism is much more mainstream now. It's easier to become a vegan. It's not about sacrifice. It's more about all the benefits you can get at every level. You feel better, and you don't have to give up on those comfort foods now. There's so many products that you can have, whether it's vegan ice cream that we're sampling today or, you know, vegan macaroni and cheese. It's just like a different world now.
We also have a banana tiramisu as well.
Wow.
Last Sunday, we had our vegan brunch as usual, and the people that were over the board of Veggie Fest came and were like, Sid and Dom's has to be here. We need Sid and Dom's. So we got invited, and we're so happy to be here. It's a lot of people here. I'm glad that the veggie revolution is starting to really take off. There you go. Enjoy.
My name is Melissa Bastian, and up on this touchscreen here, what I have is my custom Google map of all of the places around New Orleans that I know that have good vegan options. So you can access this from my blog. And then if there's any place that you know that has great vegan food that I haven't identified, because I certainly haven't found everywhere, you can let me know and I'll add it. I've had the blog for 3 years. The vegan scene was really just starting to blossom here at that point, and I wanted to make sure that everybody was aware of all of the great things that were starting to happen. It started with things like John Morales and Ovegasm. He had a pop-up brunch that was happening at Grits Bar uptown, and from there it really bloomed. A couple of other restaurants started doing vegan brunches, and just in the past year or so, we've started to get our own vegan restaurants. We have Three Potato Four, Seed, we have Superfood Bar, Raw Republic just opened up, places that are all vegan.
By show of hand, who garnishes their soup at home before you serve your friends? I don't either. You guys, the only one I use the Vitamix. So check that out. Throw in some chips. All right, a little bit of crunch in there.
So my name's Dana Hahn, executive chef and co-owner of Carmo. In the beginning, maybe we had 10-15% of our customers are vegan, vegetarian. Now it's probably 50 or 60%. And the nice thing is, for vegans and vegetarians, going out in groups or many times couples that are mixed omnivore, pescatarian, you know, gluten-free, whatever it is, they didn't always have places that they could go. So that's kind of become our niche. And we try to make sure that when we do serve something, that it's completely satisfying.
You should, in theory, be able to go to, like, any restaurant, and because, like, vegan and vegetarianism is growing in popularity, like, go and tell them, like, your diet, and they should be able to make you something, which is true, because I did that at a John Best restaurant, and they totally catered to me. Yeah, I told them, I was like, I'm a vegan, I don't eat this, and they brought me out this amazing dish, which my husband and my sister were actually jealous of.
We're going to give you an opportunity to take one of these machines home with you today. They're $4.49 for the red, the black, and the white.
Well, my name is Leah Mormon. I am co-chair and vendor coordinator for New Orleans Veggie Fest. I'm actually a lifelong vegetarian and was raised along the bayous and kind of branched out to New Orleans to be able to find a home and a community to get involved in. It's really exploding all over Louisiana. A great surprise has been its growth in Baton Rouge, Shreveport, and Lafayette. There's just an undercurrent where people are there and they're starting to get organized and they're starting to make themselves known, and the community in return is paying attention and giving us great vegan options.
What makes a protein complete? Stay tuned and we'll answer that question when we come right back. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Market. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What makes a protein complete? Protein is made up of smaller components called amino acids. A complete protein is a protein that contains all of the essential amino acids. Our bodies naturally make 12 of them, but another 9 must come from the foods we eat. Animal proteins are complete proteins. We consume those by eating meat, seafood, eggs, and dairy. So what's a vegetarian or vegan gonna do? Well, soybeans, hemp seed, buckwheat, quinoa, and blue-green algae are complete proteins, too. Blue-green algae? Getting hungry yet? Here come the incomplete proteins to the rescue. Those red beans and rice we love to eat on Monday are a combination that makes a complete protein. But guess what? You don't have to consume them together. As long as you eat 2 incomplete proteins over the course of a day, breakfast, lunch, or dinner, that's beans, whole grains, nuts, seeds, peas, or corn. Boom! You've got a complete protein. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. When you're stressed out, do you feel hungry? Lifestyle dietitian Molly Kimball's here to help us unravel that problem, stress eating. Molly, nice to see you again.
Oh, yeah. Thanks so much for having me.
So tell us about stress eating.
Usually I find when someone stress eats, quote, it's usually at night. It's not typically going to be 9 a.m., 10 a.m. It might be that witching hour, you know, before dinner, but usually it's after dinner, kind of when the world is starting to slow down. We don't have all those distractions that we had before. And there's several things happening. So one, just eating, and it's usually going to be the things that people are going to turn to are going to be chips or ice cream or cookies or whatever it is. And that action of hand to mouth, of eating whatever it is, for that split second serves as that distraction from whatever is weighing on our mind. Mm. So if we're bored, we're lonely, we're overwhelmed at work, whatever it is, that act of eating is a temporary distraction, but of course a split second distraction. It's almost a way of numbing out.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, mine is cyclical. I have cyclical stress eating. I cannot handle the end of the summer when we're in August and it looks to me like this is never going to be over. And suddenly I realize that I've taken a bite out of the refrigerator.
What I find most people reach for when they're kind of in that situation, it's usually going to be some form of carbs. Mm-hmm. And so it might be sweet carbs, it might be savory, it could be, for some people, it's stuff like Twizzlers, just sugar candy, it might be chocolate, ice cream, cookie dough, chips, like we said, French fries. But what most of those foods have in common is that they are carbs, but also with a blend of fat and salt. And when those three things are combined in a food and we eat it, it actually lights up receptors in our brain, the same receptors that addictive drugs like cocaine light up. So when someone says, I'm addicted to carbs, you actually can have a physiological reaction to eating these foods. And what happens when we eat those foods, those carbs cause this release of serotonin and other chemicals in our body that have a calming, soothing sensation. I think understanding the reaction that we have when we eat these foods can help us, you know. So number one, we're having this food as a distraction from whatever's swirling through my head. But number two, it's actually having a physiological response on my body, releasing these chemicals that have that soothing effect.
So we identify that we are exhibiting this behavior and that we're into the stress eating. What do you do next?
Well, I think by identifying it and understanding why we're doing it, you take some of that pressure off of yourself, first of all, because people get very angry at themselves. They're very hard on themselves. You know, why am I so good at all these other things I do? I can do all these other things. What's my problem? What's wrong with me when it comes to this? So I think the harder we can be on ourselves sometimes, it can make the problem worse. We're adding to that stress and we're adding to that negativity that we're feeling. So I think understanding that this is a normal thing, and here's why it happens, is one, to kind of start to relieve that burden that a lot of people feel. The other thing is to pay attention to knowing why you're doing it. Maybe I'm exhausted and I'm looking for those carbs for a pick-me-up. Okay, it's just time to turn in and go to bed. It's 11 o'clock at night. I'm not going to be energized no matter what I eat. I've just got to get to bed. And so I think when we can kind of tune in a little bit like that, and then there's other things, you know, that we can do throughout the day, eating frequently through the day, staying hydrated. One of the first signs of being dehydrated is being tired. And when we feel exhausted, we turn to those foods for that pick-me-up. So there's little things that we can do, eating frequently through the day, staying hydrated. The other thing is knowing how these, especially sugary white carbs, affect us. If we say, for example, at 10 a.m., we have a cupcake, or we start our day with donuts. Oh, well, it's just one donut. What's the problem? The problem is what it's going to cause later. It's going to cause more cravings later. We have that spike and then that crash. We want more. So we're really setting ourselves up for more carb cravings when we start with things like that.
Molly, give us some examples of what to eat as opposed to what not to eat.
So when you look at, okay, what kind of things am I craving? So if someone is raiding the vending machine every day at 3 o'clock for a Snickers bar, for example, okay, well, obviously you're craving sweet and chocolatey. There's actually a lot of pretty good tasting protein bars on the market. And if you tried it years ago and you hated it, there's a bunch of new ones. Try them again.
It doesn't have to taste like sawdust anymore.
Exactly. So there's some Power Crunch, Think Thin bars, and those might be at health food stores or gyms. We sell them at Elmwood, but they're also at Target, Sam's, Walmart. We can get these, but they'll have the same protein of about 2 or 3 ounces of meat, very, very low in sugar and carbs, and no artificial sweeteners. So I like those bars for the person who has the sweet tooth. For salty, instead of regular chips, there's chips called beanitos. They're actually made with black beans or white beans. They have a black bean chipotle or a white bean nacho cheese that's kind of like a Dorito. So those would be options that I would say, but even with those, we still have to watch portions. And when you look at a portion on something, even if you're buying the light or diet ice cream, for example, oh, it's only 90 calories. Yeah, that's for the amount that fits into a cupcake wrapper. How much are we really having in that bowl? So don't buy it. If you want it, go out and get it. You want ice cream, go get your gelato or ice cream and a scoop of it, of the real deal, and then that's all you're limited to. Or go into a place where you're going to buy the item and it's one thing, but you don't have that limitless supply at home. I think that's one of the biggest first things, first and foremost.
Do not drag that bag of cookies back over to the sofa like a big old bear.
Right. Like a bear right now.
Well, Molly, thank you. I feel better just hearing all this good advice. Thanks so much for coming to talk to us about this, and please come back soon.
Oh, thank you so much.
Molly Kimball, New Orleans lifestyle dietitian.
I know it's wrong, but I can't help but want you all, babe, to myself.
Food blogger Chris J. writes for the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau, and you can find out what's happening in North Louisiana in the food scene every Tuesday on 20by49.com. Hi, Chris. Welcome back.
Hey, Poppy. Thanks so much for having me.
So what's going on?
Well, I wanted to tell you a little bit about Cat Daddy's Old School Cafe. He is a local used car salesman, soul radio DJ, and restaurant owner.
Sounds like my kind of man.
Yeah, he's kind of one of those big, colorful, bon vivant characters that everyone knows. And that's why I wanted to tell you about this funky restaurant he owns. It's a really popular soul food kitchen. It's in West Shreveport. It's off the beaten path, so you kind of have to find it. But, you know, like a lot of soul food kitchens, great plate lunch specials daily, whether it's smothered pork chops or catfish platters or fried chicken, pick and peel style veggie sides that taste really homemade and wonderful. But it's the place and the atmosphere that's just so hard not to love. The place has got about 7 tables, but at lunchtime, there are going to be about 45 people packed in there.
Wow.
And Cat Daddy's going to be making the rounds, introducing himself to everyone. Above the checkout, there's an enormous poster-sized print of Shreveport Mayor Cedric Glover taking a selfie with President Barack Obama. There might be a pastor just making the rounds, but it's a wonderful place. I think really Shreveport's African-American community especially is full of these plate lunch houses that are really, really special. And I think traditionally they haven't been marketed really. We haven't really run that flag up the pole and said, hey, this is here and you need to experience it.
So what do you eat when you go to Cat Daddy's?
Only once in a while. You know, I'll let myself have a nice fried chicken platter. It's only dark meat. I'll get collard greens. I'll get the candied yams. I'll get, you know, the field peas. Lots of great sides here. A big chunk of cornbread comes with everything. But lunch is almost beside the point. Dessert after lunch is the main attraction. In Shreveport, a lot of the soul food restaurants are for some reason obsessed with peanut butter sheet cake. It's just an incredibly rich vanilla cake with a thick layer of peanut butter icing. And I don't know how this started, but if you go into the average soul food kitchen in Shreveport, they're going to give you a piece of peanut butter cake with your order for free, whether you want it or not. But Cat Daddy's Soul Food Cafe is the best peanut butter cake I've ever tasted in my life. Even though it costs $2.45, folks go there to pay for what they could go down the street and get for free.
And it's lunch only?
Absolutely, it is. It's 10 to 5, I think.
And is that 5 days a week?
6 days a week, including Saturday, but not Sunday. Naturally.
When does Cat Daddy find the time to sell cars?
The thing is, Cat Daddy's always at the restaurant. His car lot's down the street. I'm not making this up. If you want to buy a car, he's got a salesman on the car lot, but the salesman's going to have to come to the restaurant to get the paperwork done.
Oh, gosh, that is hilarious. Thank you, Chris. I'll tell you what, there's some crazy stuff happening in Shreveport. I'm coming to visit soon.
I can't wait, Poppy. I'd love to show you around.
Chris J., our North Louisiana Eats roving reporter. Foodies take note. The 100-foot journey is one of the most delicious films you'll see all year. The film, based on Richard Moraes' best-selling novel, tells the story of an Indian family who find themselves in Provence after a series of life-changing misfortunes. They buy an abandoned building just 100 feet across from a very elegant Michelin star-rated restaurant owned by a very French widow. She watches with horror as they turn it into an authentic Indian eatery. As I watched the drama unfold, I found myself continuously thinking of my friend, Chef Floyd Cardoz. When the credits rolled, Floyd's name appeared on the screen as consulting chef. No wonder he'd been on my mind the whole time. I called him the very next day to hear more about his 100-foot journey connection.
As I kept on reading this book, I kept on finding similarities and connections to my life. It's almost as if Richard had written my life. And there were things that he put in, purely fictional for the chef, Hassan, that were things that had happened to me in my life. So the more I read it, the more I loved the book. We became friends, and I started doing little things for the book to promote the book.
When it came time to actually make the movie, Floyd's schedule didn't allow him to be involved. But then he got a call from one of the producers, Juliet Blake.
Juliet says, we're not so happy with the way the food's turned out, and we need some food porn. Can you help us do this? Can you help us bring a little life to the food? So they flew me to Paris, and for me it was all real food, not false food like they do in commercials, because I don't know how to make false food.
This is flavor that is fighting against the chicken.
I added some spices for flavor. Did sauce and coriander for garnish and freshness.
But why change a recipe that is 200 years old?
Because, madam, maybe 200 years is long enough.
A lot of the food that I did in the shots, they gave me poetic license to say, go ahead and do what you want. Just make sure that it'll stand out on camera. So there were things I did from tabla, things that, you know, my watermelon curry I did my lamb shanks, I did my duck with orange curry, I did a salmon, I did crab cakes. So I did things which were from my past.
No wonder the handsome young Indian chef Hassan reminded me of Floyd. The food I was watching Hassan prepare on the screen with such intense feeling was actually prepared by Floyd's hands, fueled by the same emotions.
When Hassan is sitting down with the porter in the restaurant and he's eating the food and he's getting these memories of India, I came up with dishes in the tiffin box or the lunch box, which was things that were important to me, so they had some connection. So when I cooked them with a passion. So this is my wife Barca's favorite dish, so I'm going to put it in. This is my favorite dish, so I'm going to put it in. So it was a lot of fun to do that.
Have you even asked the boy what he wants?
You deliberately seduce him. You seduce his mind with your awful, tasteless, empty sauces, with your pitiful little squashed bits of garlic.
That is called subtlety of flavor.
It's called meanness of spirit. If you have a spice, use it. Don't sprinkle it. Spoon it in.
We want the food in this movie to make people feel that they want to jump into the screen and eat it.
Floyd Cardoz, consulting chef for the film The 100-Foot Journey. Make a date to see The 100-Foot Journey soon. And don't forget those dinner reservations. You're going to need them. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Don't miss our next show. We'll get a visit from Dr. Huxtable himself, the legendary Bill Cosby.
Here's what I love about going to a restaurant in New Orleans. People don't run out of things. I don't understand why people run out of food and they say they have a restaurant.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Dickie Brennan and Company, and Linda Green, the Yakaman Ladies Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Thanks to executive producer Thomas Walsh and sound engineer Joe Schreiner. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.